How does someone become a Muslim? It's very simple. You don't have to do a backflip or a dance or anything like that. Become a Muslim, it's really, really easy. All you have to say with conviction in your heart, and you can say this in front of people, or you can say it at home alone and no one has to know. Of course, it's better to have witnesses. You say, I bear witness that nothing has the right to be worshipped except God alone, and that Muhammad is the messenger of God. So if somebody makes that conviction from the bottom of their heart, okay, that they believe that there's only one God and nothing has a right to be worshipped except that one God, and that Muhammad is the messenger of God, they say that with conviction in their heart, based on knowledge, then this person has entered into the fold of Islam, and he's protected from the eternal punishment after death. Now, of course, there's the pillars of faith that come along with that, and that's part of that statement, knowing the pillars of faith, the belief in God, as we discuss a lot about tonight, the belief in his angels, his created angels, the belief in all his books that he revealed throughout history, the belief in all his messengers and prophets, the belief, the certainty in the day of judgment, and the belief in divine fate, meaning that God has a plan for us and he knows, he knows all his infinite knowledge, and he knows what's in store for everybody. And that is how someone becomes a Muslim. And of course, the five pillars of Islam, the bearing of witness to the religion is the first one, which I just mentioned. And then you have the five prayers. Then you have the charity, which is a type of charity you should give to the poor, which is another pillar. Another pillar is the fast, a month of Ramadan, fasting a month throughout the year. And the last is making the pilgrimage to Mecca. Okay. General rule in Islam is that God doesn't punish anybody until a messenger or the message has been sent to them. Christian and believed in the Trinity or Jesus or worshipped something they thought was God, and they tried their best based on that information, they died. In Islam, we don't say necessarily this person's going to go straight to hellfire. God will judge that person according to his intention and his sincerity. Now, if the knowledge comes to somebody and they deny it, just like the Jews deny Jesus, right? Did not the Jews, some of the Jews deny Jesus, right? If you would ask the average Christian, what about those Jews that planned against Jesus and disbelieved in him? After seeing all these clear signs, they tell me they go to hell. You know, even though they were believers in the Torah, the believers in Moses. So we say the same thing, that if you believe in any of the prophets and their clear message, then yes, this is something that will make you a disbeliever. So disbelief in the prophet himself or the prophets it encompasses disbelief, because if God sent this prophet to you and you reject them, in reality, you're rejecting the one who sent him. So disbelief in any of the prophets is disbelief, but that Jesus is God, but we believe in the Son of God. Again, it goes back to, what do you mean he's the Son of God? You know, because, I mean, if you want to look at it from the biblical standpoint, everybody is the Son of God in the Bible, right? Has anyone read the Bible before? David is the begotten Son of God in the Psalms. Adam is the Son of God. Jacob is the Son of God. I mean, you can go online, just type in Son of God in the Bible, and you'll find that everyone, peacemakers are the Son of God. It goes on and on. So everybody's considered the Son of God in the Bible. This term, can be used. So yes, the answer is, let me just give you a general answer to that. If anybody rejects the truth when it comes to them, yes, we believe that those people will go to hell if the information comes to them, they reject it willingly. They willingly reject it, and then God judges them according to that denial. Then yes, that person would be considered a disbeliever, just like the Jews who disbelieved in Jesus. It's the same thing. This is a very good question, by the way. What he or she is saying here is that okay. If you look, for example, in the history of, for example, at the time of the Jews, when they would sin, okay? And this, by the way, is what, unfortunately, is a misconception. When the Jews sinned, they wouldn't kill a lamb. Okay, imagine, for example, you're a liar, okay? And you lie, and trust me, there's people who lie 10, 20 times a day. At the end of the day, you don't have to go and kill 20 lambs. You know what I mean? No, you just ask God to forgive me. And actually, the answer is in the New Testament, actually. The Lord's Prayer, does anybody know the Lord's Prayer? Yeah. Let me read some of it to you. I'll learn this in Bible school. All right, now, the Lord's Prayer is, I think it's mentioned in Luke and some other chapters too. Now, imagine, the Lord's Prayer Jesus praying with his disciples. Ready? Our Lord. Our Father, our Lord in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. So Jesus is praying with his disciples, not in Jesus' name, but in God's name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses. Keyword, forgive us our trespasses. They're repenting to God. They're asking God, please forgive us. No death, no animals. Now, don't get me wrong. There was a tradition, and there still is a tradition today. We are, it's a reminder of the sacrifice of Abraham. Remember the sacrifice of Abraham, right? God commanded him to sacrifice his son, and he became a lamb. Why do we remember that day? Why do we sacrifice as Muslims that day? To remember the great sacrifice. Abraham was willing to sacrifice his son for God, and we're not willing to give up, you know, the liquor, the women, or the boyfriend. You know what I'm saying? We're not willing to give up cheating, lying, stealing, and all the evil crimes that we commit daily. I mean, this is why we have this tradition in our religion. Remember the great sacrifice, the great righteousness of Abraham and his son. And not only that, his son submitted to it. So this is how we look at the sacrifice. We don't look at sacrifice as a means of salvation. No. If you want to be saved, you know, I told somebody the other day, let's say, for example, you're really, 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 really poor. And by the way, this exists right now. There's people in this world that don't eat meat. Did y'all know that? Right? So let's say you sin and you don't have a cow to kill, or you don't have enough money to kill a cow. How are you going to be forgiven? No, God doesn't need, like I was saying before, God is not in need of the blood or the killing of an animal. All God needs is your heart. God, forgive me. I screwed up. I'm not going to do it again. And even if you fall into the sin again, he will always leave that door of repentance open for you. Doesn't mean you can play games with God because he knows what's in your heart. If you're sincere to him and you're really trying to change, he knows that. And him being the most merciful will forgive you. No need for death. No need for killing of animals. Okay? So, and I'm not going to get into the authenticity of the Bible either, but again, you're not going to be saved by killing an animal. Okay? Just not going to happen. All right? That you're not going to be held accountable unless the clear message comes to you. But it doesn't mean necessarily that usher has to come up to you and tell you, because the signs are everywhere. You know, there's a famous story, actually, it's funny, this is a good question, there's a famous story of somewhere in the Brazilian Amazon, right? And they worship idols, they worship statues, and they have their temple, right? And so everyone goes to this temple to go worship the statues, and this is part of their tradition, like we're saying, tradition, culture. So the boy went into this temple to worship the statue, right? And he's worshiping the statue, and then all of a sudden the dog comes, lifts up his leg, and pees on the statue. So the boy thinks about it. He's like, this can't be God. This is wood. You know what I mean? This is, you know, we took a tree that was useless, and we made it to a God, and it became God. I mean, at that point, the message came to him, the sign came to him, and at that point, he became a believer, even though maybe the message never reached him. So God, the signs of God are throughout. You know, this is a sign. You came to this lecture. You heard this lecture. It's obviously a sign for you. So, so again, as Muslims and as the prophets, or all the prophets of God will teach, I can't judge you. I can't say you're going straight to hell, man. You know, because people told me that before. You know what I mean? In a nice way. You're going to hell. You haven't accepted Jesus in your heart, you know. But I've been told that before. In a nice way. The point here is that you know, God will not be unjust with you. Okay, whatever question that was. God will judge you, and his justice is beyond comprehension. So if someone had never heard about God, you know, I mean, we talked about for the most part, most civilizations do believe in some sort of supernatural God. But if the person didn't have the information, or if he had some mental, you know, God's not going to treat you unjustly. He's so just and so merciful. This question basically is this, is that, basically the question here is who created God? This is basically what this question is getting at. And again, we've had a lot of discussions with a lot of our philosophy friends. I had a guy come up to me, you know, very excited, and he said, "Who created Allah?" You know, and I said that. Well, I asked a simple question. I asked him, "Do you believe that God was created?" You know, because one of his perfect names and one of his attributes is that he's uncreated. And again, it goes back to recognizing this is that God is nothing that you, like anything you can imagine. There's nothing similar to him or comparable to him. He always was, and he always is. So this question is kind of philosophical, you know what I mean? Why not that we came from nothing if God came from nothing? But God didn't come from nothing because he always existed. Because God's not like you and me. He's uncreated, and that's why he's called God. Okay? That's why somebody asked, you know, who created God? Well, we say that, well, if somebody created that God, then that's not God, because God's not created. God's uncreated. He has no beginning. He has no end. He's ever living, as we mentioned before. No, we actually believe in the Torah. We believe in the original scriptures that were revealed to Moses and Jesus. We're not denying everything in the New Testament is false. You know, I mean, I would say, look, watch. Let's look at, for example, the New Testament. I'm not a biblical scholar by any means, okay? If you ask somebody about the New Testament, you say, okay, tell me about the New Testament. Was it written by one author? They say, no. Okay, who are these authors? They say John, Luke, Matthew, Mark, Paul, all these different people. Okay? They wrote these scriptures. And I asked them this question. What language did Jesus speak? They'll say, well, some people say Hebrew, some scholars say Aramaic. Right? Okay, great. Good. Can I see your Aramaic / Hebrew New Testament in your shelf? They'll say, we don't have one. Why not? Because they were written in Greek. Okay, so Jesus came and was speaking in Aramaic and preaching in Aramaic or Hebrew. Okay? And you don't even have a book in his original language? Our book is in the language of our prophet, Arabic. You know what I mean? And you don't even have the book. Anybody who's a Muslim here, there's not one Muslim here who doesn't have a Quran in Arabic, I would say, pretty much. Unless maybe you're a new Muslim, you haven't learned Arabic. But even if you're a new Muslim, you probably have an Arabic Quran. The Quran was revealed in Arabic, and we have it in Arabic, right? So we can refer to the original source. You don't even have the original source to begin with. You know what I mean? Doesn't mean there was an original source. There was, but we just don't have it anymore for whatever reason. This is God's will. So are we denying the books that God revealed? No, we're not denying the books. What we're denying is what we have presently today. We, you know, and I always tell people this. The New Testament was written in Greek, okay? And these are witnesses for your salvation. They say, yes. Okay, great. I go, imagine you were accused of committing a crime, like murder. You're accused of it, okay? And so they bring four witnesses, okay? And these witnesses, their name is John, Luke, Matthew, Mark. Okay? And they never saw the crime take place, nor were they in your same country when the crime happened, nor did they speak your language. Is that a fair group of witnesses? Heck no! I don't want those people to be my witnesses. I'll burn in the electric chair if these people are my witnesses. Because the reality is this, is that Luke, John, Mark, Matthew, Paul never met Jesus, okay? They wrote in Greek for a European audience. They didn't write for an Aramaic audience because they weren't from it. They were in a different country. They wrote at a different time. They never met Jesus. They never explored with Jesus. And we don't even have the scripture in the original language. So I think that's proof enough that this is not a reliable source. That's true. A Muslim is anyone who submits to God. But yeah, but one you also have to submit to his revelation. That's part of submitting to God. Submitting to the articles of faith, it includes God exists and he sent messengers. So part of that submission, submitting to God, is submitting to the revelation that he revealed. Yes. Very, very, very simple. Such a simple process. You can be in the middle of a desert, no animal to slaughter, and you can be forgiven. Watch how easy this is. God, I sinned. I feel terrible that I did this. Please forgive me. I promise you I'm not going to go back to it. You're done. Sin is gone. In the middle of a desert, no animal, no buffalo to kill. Simple. Sincerely, of course. You can't do it. It's like, you can't play games with God because he knows what's in your heart. Yes, he has. Every time he sins, he should ask for forgiveness. Even though God may still forgive you for that sin out of his great mercy. Right? And we can talk more about that later if you want to. The mercy of God is something incomparable to the mercy of tradition. God is more merciful to his servant than he is than a woman is to her baby child, to her children. So we see, like, I have a child, how, you know, the mother, how merciful she is to the child. God is much more merciful than that, okay? So yes, you should be you should turn back to God in repentance for all your sins. Yes. And how does someone know if you're far away enough? Based on the teachings. I mean, if the teachings are telling you, for example, don't cheat, and you know you're not supposed to cheat, and you consistently cheat knowing that it's wrong, then there's a possibility you're going to be held accountable for that. It's possible. Yes, absolutely. There's a beautiful verse in the Quran. The human being is very well aware of his actions. He's very well aware of what he's doing, regardless of the excuses he puts forth. Meaning that you're very well aware of yourself. You know for sure if you're doing something wrong or not. This is something that someone's presented to me before. You Muslims aren't guaranteed heaven. We are. I mean, first thing I tell them is, so you're guaranteed to go to heaven? Yes. Well, then why don't you pray from the bottom of your heart that God calls you to die tonight, not wake up from your sleep? Of course, they'll never do that. I mean, nobody wants to die. I mean, if you're so certain you're going to go, I mean, to me, that's very arrogant. I'm going to heaven. No doubt about it. You know what I mean? And unfortunately, I went to Auburn University, and it's definitely the Bible Belt. You have these people, and I'm not saying anything, but one of the things that I was so unreligious in college, I was part of Campus Crusade for Christ. I used to be part of Chi Alpha. You know what I mean? And I would hear these statements coming out of these people's mouths. And at the same time, many of them were committing fornication and all these kind of acts. You know what I mean? So how in the world am I going to... I'm not saying that all Christians are that way, but I'm saying, like, the reality is that, you know, this notion of having all this extreme hope is never going to give you the... Let me give you an example. I got to talk about this. I'm sorry. Imagine you come to class one day. Imagine. And it's a full class. The teacher gives out the syllabus, okay? And he goes, okay, first thing I wanted to let you guys know, regardless if you come to class or not, everybody passes. How many people are going to come for class the next day? Maybe one idiot, but for the most part, you don't. No, think about it. I'm not even joking. Think about it for a second. How many people would come to class? Why wouldn't they come to class? Because there's no incentive to come. I mean, hey, I'm forgiven for my sins. It's not going to give you an incentive to do the righteous deeds and to stay away from evil. It's that simple. I mean, you know, God created you in this life in a way that, like, makes sense. It's something that, like, it shouldn't be something philosophical or deep. Very, very simple. God has warned about these sins, so I'm going to stay away from them. If you sincerely, and you know if you're being sincere or not, repent for them, God's forgiven you, guaranteed. And if you die upon the monotheistic religion that God revealed through his prophets, you're promised to go to heaven. If a person died in the time of Jesus, and he prayed to God as one God, and he believed that Jesus was the messenger of God, he goes to heaven, guaranteed. Okay? So this is a belief that we have. In the Bible, it says, he created them, male and female, in his image. He created them. All creation has masculine, feminine, internal, external manifestation. Jesus was the male manifestation of his image. Was there to be a female woman who should manifest this image of God? Then together they stand in the total image of God. We don't believe God is female or male. I mean, I'll just answer that question with that. We don't believe God is God. And there are some groups out there that believe God is a female because God gave birth to a son, you know, but you know, I think that's kind of a far-fetched group. So no, we don't believe that God is male or female or that we also don't believe there's anything similar to him or like him. Okay, so we're not similar to him or like him in any way. So the idea of us, like God became, like, I'll finish the story with this. There's an article in Time Magazine, and it was talking about the growth of Islam in the world. And a lot of African Americans have become Muslim in the West, primarily, and of all nations and origins. But they asked the guy in the interview. They said, "Why? You know, what attracted you to Islam? Why did you leave Christianity?" He said, "You know, when I heard about the belief of Muslims, and I heard about the belief of God, it just opened up my heart." And then he said, "And then I just never believed that God became a white guy." Yeah. That was what he said. He said, "I don't believe that God entered into creation as a white person. Why didn't he become a black person? Why didn't he become a Chinese person? Why, you know, what do you think this puts in the image of the eyes of people when you go to I'm in the room? If you go to the Sistine Chapel, Michelangelo drew God. What color was he? Anybody know? He was white. Is God white? No. God's not like us in any way, shape, or form. He's not white, he's not black, he's not Chinese, he's not Asian. That's why there's a verse in the Quran. It says God has created you in tribes, so you will get to know each other You'll benefit from each other, and the best of you are those who are most righteous. It has nothing to do about, I'm a Jew, I'm better than you. No, there's nothing like this in Islam. It has no, there's no, I'm a Jew, I'm better, I'm white, I'm better, God is white. Or, no, God is not a guy with a white guy with a gray beard. No, this is not true. God is not a white person. He's just not. You know? And that's why you'll find people of many different races becoming Muslims, because they recognize that, yes, God is different from us. He's not created. Because a lot of people, why did they draw God as white? Because Jesus is white. He's a light-skinned Jew, right? But he was a messenger from God, a prophet from God.